The views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Social Justice Forums. I am Daren Jaime. Our show focuses on the inequities that many people face. We promote multiple points of view, we promote civic engagement, and we have some great guests. We encourage you to stay with us as the Social Justice Forums begin right now. Welcome back. Advocates for Children of New York is an organization that's dedicated to protecting every child's rights with education, focusing on students from low-income backgrounds who are struggling in school or experiencing school discrimination of any kind. Now, the organization recently released a new data analysis estimating more than 300,000 public school students do not have a parent that speaks English fluently. Join me now in sharing more. We got staff attorney at Immigrant Students' Rights Project of Advocates for Children, Diana Aragundi. And Diana, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me, Aaron.
And so automatically from the jump, when we look at the fact that a student doesn't have a parent that actually speaks English fluently, translate that into the difficulties it is in navigating through the educational process.
Of course, definitely. When we have students whose parents do not speak English fluently, it means that their ability to communicate meaningfully with their child's school, get information about how their child is doing in school, get information about what's happening at the school is limited, right? And so what we really noticed was that, especially during the pandemic, with everything being remote, so many of our families, so many of our immigrant families did not have access to the information the same way other families do. And in addition, other factors, including like digital literacy, access to broadband internet access, meant that so many families were just basically kept out of the education process. So they weren't able to log in and see how their child was progressing. They weren't getting report cards. They weren't getting announcements. And a lot of families were reaching out to us very frustrated because they weren't able to participate in their child's education. So, our data analysis shows that there's broad swathes of families that are being kept out and not able to meaningfully participate in their child's education. And even though we are back in school, we see these issues continue to be out there. So we want to make sure that immigrant families are able to participate in their children's education.
Yeah, I have the statistic that the estimated 55,585 students have parents that have no more than an eighth grade education. So when we talk about navigating the school system, even though a parent can be present, sometimes to be able to assist them in their day-to-day classwork or navigating the system can be really complex.
Definitely. And also, if you know, we talk about the DOE has put a lot of information online, right? A lot of the information is translated in the 9 covered languages. But if you have a parent who's doesn't have an education, no more than eighth grade education, a lot of those documents are very technical and difficult to access for a lot of our immigrant families. And so it's unfortunate because families need different types of approaches. They need a multifaceted approach to get information. They need information that's accessible and really meant for broad families, not just for families that are able to interpret the information that the DOE is sharing. So we have noticed that that is a challenge. And we would like to see more information in different types of media, ethnic media, different forms of language. So it's not just for families that have difficulty with literacy, videos. There are so many other ways to reach families than just putting things online. And we know that for a lot of our families, they're not getting there.
Yeah. So you had this report and we saw the numbers that came out of it. Talk to us about the report and some of the findings that you found coming from this.
Definitely. So we did a data analysis using the U.S. Census Bureau American Community Survey for the 2020-2021 school year. So as you mentioned before, about 30% or 329,000 of New York City public school students have a parent who does not speak English fluently. We estimate out of that, there's an estimated 55,585 students whose parents do not have more than an eighth grade education. And estimated 61,657 students are children of limited English proficient parents, and they live in a household with no access to broadband or internet access. This is obviously really, really, it has become even more important, right? As we've moved from COVID and being remote to being in this hybrid environment where a lot of students are still using the iPads and the devices they got during during the pandemic. And then we also estimated that about 29,608 students have parents who are have limited English proficiency and also speak in languages outside of the top nine languages that the DOE typically routinely translates all documents. So we have clients who speak Mixteco, who speak Quechua, who speak languages that are not, covered or low incidence languages, and maybe speak Spanish as their third language. And so these families are being kept out of being able to meaningfully participate as well.
So when we look at this here, obviously a lot of work needs to go forward. Your organization is front and center, really dealing with the matters. Talk to us about the work that you're doing right now and trying to bridge this gap.
Definitely. So a lot of the work, there is a work group that was, last year there was funding, there was $4 million in funding to bridge this gap. And AFC is a part of that work. And a lot of that funding was targeted towards going into using local ethnic media so that they could provide updates from the Department of Education, conversations about sending paper notices to families, reaching families over the telephone and text messages, as well as collaborating with community-based organizations, CBOs, the organizations that families trust. And so a lot of that work continues, and we're encouraged that the Department of Education, that the city has renewed the ask, and there is now $4 million in the budget for this upcoming fiscal year. And we're encouraged by that, and we really think that, immigrant family communications need to continue. We need to continue, even as we're moving away from this remote world, we need to continue to prioritize immigrant family communications so that families feel encouraged and feel like they can participate meaningfully in their child's education.
So there's some money that was allocated, $4.4 million, I should say, base funding for the program. Talk to us about how this has been able to assist.
As I mentioned before, a lot of that money has been going into community-based organizations so that they can work directly with families in their language. And so we are encouraged by the DOE and by the City Council in recognizing that this is important and a priority. We are, hopeful that this coming year we'll be able to continue having diverse methods of communicating with families, having this multifaceted approach, which includes using ethnic media, which includes paper documents. A lot of our families just do not have access to the internet or would not know how to access documents online. And so being able to communicate with families and meet them where they are is of utmost importance.
Yeah. So when we look at what's going on right now, there is this gap that you're trying to bridge. A lot of families are really struggling in this area. How are you going about locating these families to be able to help and assist?
So at Advocates for Children, we have families, a lot of the families that we work with, whether they reach out directly to our helpline or through community-based organizations that refer families to us, we're able to work with families directly in that way. We also have relationships with CBOs. And so a lot of families are reaching out to their community-based organizations. They're reaching out to their to people that they trust. And that is how we're getting the information, right? A lot of the anecdotal information I'm sharing today is really because of those relationships that we've established. And We know that if we're talking to a few families and they're experiencing this issue, we know it must be more families are experiencing this issue. So we want to make sure that we speak for the families that are not reaching us, right? We know that there are so many others that don't know and therefore are being kept out.
Are you pleased, or I should say satisfied, with the fact that, you know, elected officials and also the Department of Education is really recognizing that this is a growing need, and the fact that so many people are being literally caught in the mix here, and the fact that also you've got families that are trying to make the best educational life for their child, but sometimes just don't have the resources or the capacity to be able to bring it home?
Yes, we're very appreciative and encouraged that the funding was renewed for this year. We did ask for, you know, our ask was for $6 million. We are encouraged that the city has decided to renew the $4 million that was in the budget last year. And, you know, we are always encouraged, and we want to continue working with the Department of Education and with our community-based organizations to keep pushing for greater help and greater support for our immigrant families. The families that I work with on a daily basis are so invested in their children, and they're invested in their children's success. They need help communicating. They need access to their schools and, you know, increasing families' ability to communicate with their schools is really is paramount to that success.
Yeah. And so for yourself, obviously, you're pretty dedicated to this work and knowing the needs that are affecting the immigrant community. Talk to me about how this has really been impacted since COVID, because I think COVID definitely further exacerbated a lot of things. But for you, what's been your take on things since COVID? Have you seen a greater increase in need?
Definitely. I think what COVID did was it definitely highlighted not just the literacy divide or the communication divide, but also the digital divide, right, between our families. So many of our families do not have access to broadband internet, do not, speak other languages, and had a really hard time, especially at the beginning of the pandemic, to access information. And so, at Advocates for Children, we worked with families, we created guides, we walked them through, we got on FaceTime and helped them, you know, log into Google Classroom and figure out how to access, their learning platforms for their children. And while that's no longer where we are now, right, with children back in school, so our families continue to tell us that they don't know what's going on because they're not getting things in the mail. They're not getting letters that come in, or if the letters come in from school, they're in English, or they don't know what's happening with, you know, the meetings are still occurring by phone. You're not going into schools for parent-teacher conferences. And so it is really challenging for families that do not, you know, that do not speak English fluently to advocate for their children. So it's very important that we continue to explore different avenues so that families are able to communicate meaningfully with their child's school.
Diana, I wish you could share a little bit more, because you also do some work with immigrant students' rights, and there's an immigrant students' rights project. Can you make our viewers a little bit more aware of that?
Definitely, yes. So I am a staff attorney on the Immigrant Students' Rights Project. We work with immigrant families and immigrant students in New York City schools. We help families enroll children in bilingual education programs and appropriate English language learner programs. We also help with special education needs. And so we have students who require special education classes. We provide trainings and workshops for the community. And we also take on direct legal representation for families who require that. So we do a host of different things, and we work with low-income families who need that support.
And so for people who want to find out more information, get connected with the work that you do, how do they go about doing that?
Definitely. So for families who are interested and have access to the internet, they can go to our website at advocatesforchildren.org. We also have a helpline that families or, you know, anyone can call if they have any education-related issue. they can contact us at 866-427-6033.
And right now, what would you identify as the biggest challenge that you're trying to overcome?
Well, I mean, that's a very broad question. And I feel like it depends, right, on the day of the week and which family I'm working with. I do think communication is central to a lot of the issues that our families experience, because whether it's a special education issue or a student who is learning English and needs an appropriate and effective English language learner program, families are not, if they're not able to communicate with the schools effectively, if they're not able to be informed of the choices they have, a lot of decisions happen without their input. And so being able to have increased like transparency with communication and access for families is really, I think, one of the major issues that we experience and one of the ways that we try to help families.
So when we talk about families, obviously we know that so many of them are saddled with so many different things they're trying to contend with. You know, sometimes it's, you know, food insecurity, things like that, and just really surviving on day to day. But can you give us a little bit of insight into what it means to have this language barrier, because and how that really plays out in the life of the people that you serve?
Definitely. And yes, and I want to uplift that. So many of our families are going through housing insecurity, food insecurity, and they, you know, especially with COVID, so many families lost their jobs, right? A lot of our families weren't working and have other ancillary issues that also affect them besides their child's education. And so it can be very challenging for families to juggle all that. I think for a lot of our families, like not being able to communicate with their schools is very frustrating, and it's very difficult because they are so invested. And so I've had families try to communicate using Google Translate. I've had them try to communicate, going in person and trying to find someone at the school that can interpret for them. It becomes very challenging when you have a parent who works full time and can't go to the school. And a lot of schools are not open, right, for people to come in because of COVID. So it is like a daily struggle for a lot of families, especially when they are interested. They want to know how their child is doing. They want their child to make progress. And so it's difficult. And it's an ongoing issue. And obviously, like any other thing, some schools are better at it than others. But we want this to be something across the board, right? We want something that is across the board a good experience for families, so that it doesn't matter if you go to a school where there's better communication. All schools should be providing immigrant families with multi-faceted approaches so that they can feel like they're part of the community.
Diana Aragundi, thank you so much for being with us. We appreciate your work, and thank you for being here on the Social Justice Forum.
Thank you for having me.
All righty. Well, we want you to stay with us. We do have more show. Don't go anywhere. We're continuing right after this. Thank you.
When taking public transportation, don't touch your phone. Carry hand sanitizer and use it immediately upon leaving the bus or train. Avoid touching your face. If someone is coughing or sneezing, move away. Wash your hands with soap and water as soon as possible. Limit contact with poles. If possible, avoid rush hour. Don't eat or drink on public transportation. Keep your bag off the floor or other surfaces. Avoid directly touching turnstiles. Stay up to date with the latest from your local health department and CDC.
Thank you. We built a media network for you.
BronxNet TV.
Come learn in your new state-of-the-art studios at Lehman College.
At Mercy College.
And coming soon to the South Bronx in the Hub.
Inspire with your stories, culture, history.
Your Bronx on BronxNet.
Engage with us.
Connect with us at your channels and at BronxNet.tv.
Learn, engage, inspire. BronxNet TV.
From the Bronx
to the world.
BronxNet.
Ruling, the Supreme Court overturned Roe v. Wade, which is the 1973 decision that established the constitutional right to abortion in the United States. Now, the opinion is the most consequential Supreme Court decision in decades and will transform the landscape of women's reproductive health in America. Join me now is the founder of lead advocate at the Federation of International Gender and Human Rights, Dr. Ameena Ali, and she's been here before. She's here again. And Dr. Ali, glad to have you back. I'll start first of all with, we talked about this before. We talked about when it was first leaked out, and no surprise, but let me get again your reaction to now the official overturning of Roe v. Wade.
Well, thank you, Daren. And you know, I can honestly say that this landmark decision, as you said, the 72 decision, that change the lives and the responsibilities of this autonomy for women really, really set a precedent. But Friday opened doors to that change. We now realize that we cannot do this with the help of the government. We have to do this for ourselves. And there has been a groundswell to this grassroots organization, this meaningful march that is going on in our household rather than outside. And we are getting ready for this ethical and equitable lens of change to happen, because it's gonna happen. So I'm ready whenever you are. Let's go with this.
Well, we're going right at it. When we talk about the law itself, obviously, many people have spoken out saying that this wasn't even called for. Where did it come from? All of a sudden, the Supreme Court makes a ruling. Where did it come from?
Well, it came from a local Mississippi ruling. And I'm glad you asked that, because I was going to bring that into to claim. It is a local Mississippi, little rural, small town Mississippi. It was a 15-week abortion that they reviewed. And they saw that the review of that case really put into question the woman and her choice into review. And it spurred this expanded matter case. So what they did is they took the case and they said, let's look at this. Let's pick it apart. Let's see what this is about, why this is. And then they took the matters of that case and their agency, which is the Supreme Court, remember, highest court in the land, used their powers and their agency to set a precedent on a national level. So they took rural Mississippi and set it for the 50 continental states and Alaska, Hawaii, and Puerto Rico. And they said that they wanted to review Roe v. Wade and review it on a national scale and on the federal level. So like I was saying before, they took it from legal or lawful in the law that they gave us to political now. And they're doing that for a reason.
And what reason is that?
Well, first of all, they can't. Let's just understand that. They have the jurisdiction to be able to review laws, review sanctions of laws, and review the amendments to those laws, especially when it deals with the Constitution. They have that right in order. Then they have the precedence to detail it, whether it be a federal mandate, which means for everyone in the United States, or will it be a state by state legislature? Then they put into it why they are saying it, why they're sanctioned. And this could mean something as little as, you know, too many people are dying because of this and they want to change the laws to protect the people, or not enough people are vented in that manner, which means it only pertains to a small population, so we're going to expand it for a greater population, and they expand the option. But never once has their lifetime, and we call it lifetime appointment, has any representation of body, executive, judicial, whatever, has ever changed a law that we have not asked to be reviewed. Never. So we have to ask what this was. First of all, the distraction was when they nominated Juneteenth as a holiday. That was the distraction because they wanted to get everybody all hyped up about something that they've been asking for years. Now, all of a sudden, in the clear blue, they're just going to announce it that Juneteenth is a national holiday. But what was that was the distraction, because they already had that in rights that they were going to announce it almost on the same day. And they did that because their allegations to this was the duality of intention to change laws in one way to make it look like we gave you something because we're about ready to take something away. And that was where we needed to see the big shoe to drop when they gave us Juneteenth, because I sure was curious as to why they did that, especially this year when there was no precedence for this year for it to happen.
When we look at where we are right now, obviously a lot of states have taking this immediately into effect. We saw states moving swiftly, but then we see New York, and New York saying that we're going to be a sanctuary state for those persons who are considering abortion. Your thought on New York being a sanctuary state?
Absolutely. Oh my goodness. Never in life has people of color and womanhood ever been put together until now. We always see Black women this, or women this, or Black people this. We never see Black women of color or Black women in the sanction of it until now, because we know it affects most people, especially most women of color in this right. So that has been a new term. People of color or women of color has been put into terms so that we have both the orientation and the sexuality added in there. But New York went one step further, which I love it. They said, not only are we going to be a sanctuary, but we're going to be an education state. That just went in, I think, this week, where we're going to not only have the education, but we're going to instill it in our schools, our homeschool matters, and make it even an elective if we're going into college or liberal arts pieces. Of course, it's not going to start until probably September or January, but we're making certain that not only do they get the availability, but they get the education for preventive matters. Remember, Roe v. Wade was woven into our view when we voted for it. But now it seems as though it's being cast as a political opinion. The political opinion is that we shouldn't have it. It shouldn't be delegated federally. It should be given to the states. And then only the states that want to ban it and make it illegal so that we can increase the detention numbers or the incarcerated numbers of people that are doing that. But it's an invasion of privacy. It started with the COVID thing where they had to make us show health cards and make us show that we were inoculated to the people that were serving us, you know, when you go put into restaurants. But we, you know, the people in the restaurants never showed us our COVID card. You know, you serving our food, can you show us your COVID card? Now they're taking that a little step further. They realize they got the win in that. They were allowed to invade your health disparity. They were allowed to get into your health care network. They were able to show you cards. So now what they're doing with this, and you'll see health-wise, is they're making it almost a public matter if you have an abortion, almost like getting a COVID shot. They're going to make it so that the medical records will be released so that prosecution can happen. That is such a breach of confidentiality, such a breach of personal space and advantageousness that I've even heard in the buzz that if this actually goes through, that they start making it illegal in certain states, and people, it's going to be a mass exodus, and there's going to be more people in New York than we know what to do with.
Well, there are potential legal consequences. There are potential legal consequences for people in New York State who will assist people from out of state to have this abortion. Talk to us about that, because this could be pretty much landmark in itself too, because while we are a sanctuary state, if some lawmakers have their way, they're saying, You do that in New York, you keep that in New York. Don't let it come across the border, because if it comes across the border, there's going to be consequences for that abortion provider.
Correct. And that's correct. Being a sanctuary state, just understand, most people here are sovereign, but sanctuary state is just that. You can lay in comfort here in the state. So let's just understand what the word sanctuary means. And it is described as somewhere where you can gain rest. So when you're a sanctuary state, when it deals with abortion, abortion rights, and the access to it, it is not only affording based on the states, if the states can ban it, they can also accept it. So they have to have that duality, and they cannot erase that from the fabric of the lawful practice. If you have states that say it's illegal, that's fine, but then there's gonna be states that allow it, and you cannot have precedence against that. So what that means, as I told you, is gonna be a mass exodus, because people are gonna be coming into the states, gaining residence to be able to do this, and then may be able to leave and go back. But once they gain residence, there's nothing other states can do. So there's going to be a tally in New York where there's going to be an influx of people, or there's going to have to be rules changed, laws changed. And those that are practicing here. I'm hoping that if we get more people that are coming here, that we get more physicians, more medical care, because that's going to mean not only just for abortions, but there's going to be access to more medical care here in New York, which is going to make a landmark in access to care. That's what we've been asking for years. Have more available, languaged, and culturally competent medical practitioners here in New York anyway. So if this is the way to bring it in, then it's a win-win for those that are looking for this. Now, on the con side of this, New York is going to be a sanctuary state for the simple fact that there isn't any other, if you think about it. Look around New York. There isn't any other. So who else is going to do that? Are we going to go out west? Are we going to go up north? Are we going to cross the border into Canada? Are we going to go into Mexico and some of the places in the Caribbean? I mean, where else are we going to sanction ourselves in this sanctuary area? Where else are the women going to be able to have this net? So we have to look at, you know, we could talk about the negativity on the con side of being a sanctuary state, but who else is going to do that? And when your child is saved from a clothesline or a hanger abortion, and they're saved from the proclivity of that, and they are healthy after their abortion, you're gonna thank New York.
Talk to me about women that you've been talking to in your network. What's been the reaction? What's been the conversation right now since the decision's officially been handed down?
Wow. First of all, lifetime appointments should end. That's the first thing. Supreme Court, SCOTUS, should not have a lifetime appointment. It worked in the beginning, and like we said in a previous interview, it worked in the beginning and it served its purpose because we didn't have anybody there. We wanted to make sure someone would always be there. That's fine. But there is a disconnect from SCOTUS and the people that they serve. They're actually older. Most of them there are older than the generations that they're serving. And 80% of them, and we just looked, are not even childbearing anymore. We looked at those that are right. So how are you dealing with a measure that is not even dealing with the generation that you're in? Then we're looking at those regulations that they're setting a precedence for, and they're getting ready to be gone, so to speak. You know, some of them are 70, 80 years old, and they're about ready to leave this earth. So you're leaving a mark on society that we have to live with and our children have to live with. And that's what we're saying needs to be reviewed. So the conversation is saying that Roe v. Wade was written by white males for the women that it didn't pertain to. It was pertaining to women of color, women of indigeny, and those that were undocumented. And it was rules of inclusion that did not, that disallowed option. So when we took this new thing that happened Friday, we took all the people that were already disadvantaged and pushed them behind. They were already left behind. Now we pushed them behind. So now we need to put into place a lens of help and support for each other in the solution. So we're going to carry it to our own homes. So we're making educate right now. After I get off this interview, I have to sit in a meeting at 2 p.m. and I have to set a precedence for academia to introduce this, and how we're going to introduce it into high schools and into colleges and freshman year and all of the things that are going to matter, where abortion rates are the highest. How are we going to add this as an adage, and what are we going to put into place so that they are not only educated, but they're protected and the resources are there for them?
Yeah. And the conversation among students. I mean, obviously you're going into the classroom, as you said, talking about preparing and having that kind of dialogue. What do you say to people who really are troubled by this? Because you have some people who are in support and you have many that are troubled by it. But what's the word that you say to those people who are troubled by it?
Well, I say, don't despair. Worry has never changed anything. I think if you're educated, if you're properly informed, and if you're responsible for your reproductive justice that you have, then it really isn't anything to worry about, because this doesn't even apply to you. I say this to the women I mentor and the women that are pregnant now. I say, if you chose to have this baby and this is a part of your family planning plan, then you really have nothing to worry about. This is so far beyond need. However, there is a woman that is going to be raped. There's a woman that's going to be a survivor of molestation and incest. There's going to be a child that is going to be riddled without allowance for them to assume their own assumptions of their sexuality, that is going to be handled by a man that is probably twice or three times older than her in a sexual manner, resulting in a pregnancy. And we are seeing this happen now, before the Roe v. before Friday. And we're saying that the resources still need to be there. But the thing that we're saying the most, and I think that one of the things that AOC even mentioned, she said that, you know, abortion actually saved the reputation and the marriages of some of these high ranking officials. And she even said even GOP officials. And now that they are out of their prime and no longer having that option, now abortion has to be reviewed. And it was funny that she would be the one to say that, but it is so true that, you know, it's women that are sanctioned in their family planning that are not worried about this. They know they want to have a baby in 5 years. So then, you know, even if they're married, they know that their plan is responsible enough to not have a baby. But for those that are attacked, those that are sanctioned to make that choice or have that decision, they're making sure that their education is including sanctuary states and the rules of the game now that we are here. So we're hitting the ground running. We're making sure that the rules are in place and that the education will go forward so that they can make these intelligent decisions with real-time information.
I know that you got the boots on the ground. You talked about getting ready to move on in the class and get ready for this, but talk to me about how long have you actually been getting ready for this? We knew that this was possibly leaked out before last time we talked, but how long have you been in preparation for or anticipation of this actual moment coming to pass?
Well, I am a young Black woman in the United States, and I say young Black because I want to believe that my voice is still energetic. And I am in this for the very reason that every woman of color is in it, for equality and justice. Before we had this overturning of Roe v. Wade, which I just hate to even say it, but before we even had this, back in 2008 or 9, we were setting up classes to have proper registration and amalgamation with family planning, making sure you understood the difference between a birth product and a birth control method, making sure that you knew your choices and options in this, making sure that women were educated in not just using, you know, abortion as birth control, but using the guidelines of proper family planning as their go-to mark. So we've been doing this since about 07 legitimately. Now, of course, we've been doing it since I started in medicine in the 90s, but we have been doing it legitimately since about 07. And we didn't even use Roe v. Wade because, again, we didn't even see this coming until like 2010, 2012. Then when 2015 hit and they started talking about Roe v. Wade and overturning it, and then we had these political bonfires that happened in society with the deaths of Black and brown individuals, we decided that we were going to up the ante. We were starting to start programs that was designed for fifth and sixth graders, and now third and fourth graders, where we're starting to talk about this so that they become more used to the conversation. But what we have been doing is educate. That is the far and above the greatest precipitating measure to stop abortions in its infancy in this new going forward. And I say infancy because our plans are not new, but the motivation and the movement of it certainly is.
So for you right now, obviously a lot of concern, a lot of education, a lot of information that's going to be out there to your students and to those in your community. How do you get the word out for what is available for New York women? How do you get the word out for what's available for those persons who may still want to consider abortion?
You know, it's funny that you asked me what is out there. It's always been out there. You can go to your neighborhood Planned Parenthood, which is the macro level. The meso level is go to your doctor. That's the local level. That's, you know, go to your doctor, start asking questions. Stop allowing the doctors to tell you what they want for you and start saying, this is what I want, how do I get it? Or this is what I need, how do I acquire it? Stop allowing the doctors to tell you what their plan is for your reproductive life. Then on the micro level, you can go to educators like myself. My organization, the Federation of International Gender and Human Rights, of course, is a great premise. You can go to our website, FIGHR.org. All of that information is there. It's FIGHR.org. We can put that in a measure of goodness and granting. There are scholarships there for education that's there. There are school programs and projects that we're putting into place. And there are definite education models that we are exacting as of September of this year into the school system so that we can get this education out sooner than later.
Dr. Ali, what do you say to the critics who say, listen, abortion is murder and it just simply is the taking of a life. And so the ones who celebrate Roe v. Wade and the ones who say, we celebrate the fact that abortion is murder and taking of a life and the Supreme Court made the right decision.
Okay. There is not a person that I am hearing that is hearing my voice, that you know, that I know, that anyone in the sound of this episode has not been affected by abortion, whether it be through a medical abortion because the child is unfit, whether it was a choice between the mother or the child through a health disparity, or whether it was knowledge that the child will not live past birth and decided to end the abortion. Everyone has been affected by abortion. We're not looking at the person that, oh, I had random last night sex with someone and now I'm pregnant. We're talking about someone that is walking down the street on her way home and is attacked and raped and now is resulting by pregnancy. Or the woman that finds out that her child has Tay-Sachs disease or some disease that knows that the baby probably will not have a quality of life or will not live past birth. Or a woman that is in a medical throes between keeping the baby and keeping the mother alive and has to make that decision, or the family has to make that decision. This is where we are looking at where abortion should be legalized. We are looking at it for the medical constituency of those that need it, not those that want it and want the access to it. We want it for the legal ramifications of those that have to make that decision because it is life or death. We are wanting women to have choice and we're wanting men to step out of our choice. It is men that are making this a hot button topic, and it is men that decided to overturn something for women. I didn't see any measure for any kind of blue pill law into place. And I didn't see anything where they're controlling where men can have sex. Case in point, women can have sex every day for a year, 365 days, but they can only get pregnant one day a year. One day. And they can only stay pregnant throughout that entire year. So whether they get pregnant in January or December, they can only get pregnant one day a year. Then that same man, or a man having the same sex every day for 365 days can literally sire 365 babies. So who needs the birth control now? You're looking at one woman having one pregnancy that she may choose to abort based on the mate or her choice. But we have men that are procreating on such a wide span that are impregnating these women and are not giving the accountability of that at conception. So we're harnessing the blame on the woman because she's committing the act, but we're not coming into this for the men. If we had child support for conception, a law that says that you have to pay for it if you are part of it. If she has to go through it, you have to pay for it. If she is getting legal ramifications of it, if we prove that that is your child, that you should pay part of her court costs, let's put that into parameters. Let's put that into perspective. Let's allow the men to be equally as responsible for that child rather than throwing the women under the bus simply because she made a decision.
I want to talk a little bit about the backlash that's been going on. Several protests have been made since this decision has been going on. Talk to us. I know you've had firsthand experience of the protests.
That's right. Union Square on Friday was 418 strong, as she said. And we had all of the people rained out and everything. And we were still standing there with our microphone that was drenched in water, but was so powerful in the energy. And we stood before those that we knew was going to hear our voice, and we protested. And we said, our voice is going to be heard. And that night is where we sat down and we developed our educational plan and our legal plan that we're going to deal with new lawyers coming into law and new doctors coming into medicine, that they are going to begin to educate. And we're going to have them to educate on reproductive rights and reproductive responsibility. And this is going to be a law and medicine meshing. So we're going to take it from our voices and our wounds into the lawmakers and the hands of those that are coming up. So freshman lawmakers, new doctors and new lawyers are going to hear our voice, and they're going to hear it for the first time in such a veracity that is going to embed it into their tenure as a doctor, as a lawyer, as a politician. So they're going to only know, just like when you become a doctor, you know AIDS now, and you know the suffrage of COVID now. It's woven into the factor of your medical practice or your legal practice. We're going to weave this Roe v. Wade piece into their legal practice, their medical practice, and educational practice, as well as the politicians as well.
Yeah. Are you satisfied with what you're hearing by New York lawmakers and those in power in New York?
Some of them are not speaking, and silence is an answer. Some of them are speaking very loud and almost speaking for us. The AOCs of New York are saying things that we need to hear, and that's why she's in that seat. But there are some that are specifically quiet. And these are the ones that we really want to hear from because they actually backed a leader. These are the ones that we aren't hearing much from. Then there are some that is so pervasive. Sitting senators are saying, okay, we did Roe v. Wade. Now let's do Brown versus the Board of Education. What? Did you just say that? You know, I looked at that tweet and I said, are you serious? And showed his face. You know how sometimes they blur the face or do some kind of nom de plume on social media and say certain things. No, they show their face. They are emboldened to this. And now they are more conscientious to be able to say the things that they want to say, because they know now that they think that they have a voice. There's always been more of us than there are of them. And their tenure to turn their office into a vice and vessel for their good is something else that we're looking at also. So we're waiting for their voice to come out. We're waiting for the saturation of their voice and what it really means. And then the silence, what we're going to take that to mean as well.
Yeah. Are you concerned? You brought up Brown versus Board of Education. Are you concerned? Many people have said this is a possibility that could also reach the Supreme Court as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because there is no stopping. They managed to get through the Privacy Act through COVID. They did that in a landslide. And it actually surprised me because I didn't think the AMA or HIPAA, the hospital regulations, I didn't think they were going to go for that. I thought they were just going to say, nope, it's a violation of privacy. We're not going to have these cards out here. They stopped doing it with immunization cards with the kids because they realized it was a violation of privacy. So now they bring out cards with the CDC and using the sovereignty of CDC to be able to bring these cards out. And it was just wrong. But they got away with it. So now they're more emboldened. So now they took Roe v. Wade, which is the next set of laws that they wanted to overturn. Now, Brown versus Board of Education, they've been trying to do that, but there's too many people in legislature that voted for that. They're still sitting senators, and so that's going to take a while. They may have to die out or resign or retire or do something before they manage that. But there's too many seating congressmen and women that voted into that or voted that to continue the Brown versus Board of Education. So they're going to do, and it's not too many people that's going to go for that anyway. Roe v. Wade is just a subset of a subset, but it affects women in its totality. But it's not something that I think Roe v. Wade is, it was a what is it? They took our temperature with that to see what that is. So now we're going to be preemptive with such things as Brown versus Board of Education.
Dr. Ameena Ali, love hearing your voice. Thank you so much for sharing with us and bringing us to into the light and to the education of what's going on. Glad to have you.
Thank you. Glad to be here. And I really appreciate all that you're doing and all that you're making visible for this topic. I'll see you again soon.
All right, see you soon. All righty, well, I want to let you know that we've come to the end of our show today. We hope you enjoyed this week's discussion on the Social Justice Forum. Rewatch the episode or rewatch the recablecast right here on BronxNet TV or also on BronxNet.org. And if you want to join the conversation, don't forget to present your point of view on our social media platforms at BronxNet TV. I'm Daren Hyman. Until the next time we meet, we'll elevate the conversation, continue the discussion, and bring some more lively guests on Social Justice Forums. Take care.